We have more than 60% of our students who are first time, if they go to college, they would be first time, first generation college students. We're building a system that says, what do you need?
One of the most essential parts of our system is having our kids on teams. We have been teamed at the high school long before I got here, which is, I've been here for 20 years. It's like their cohort who they travel with. It makes the big school feel small, which is very helpful for these kids. That when they have this small family setting, it's really hard for them to fall through the cracks because we are watching them.
Our belief is that all students can learn, and to a high degree. So the proficiency-based system is really, how do you match up what your philosophy is for what is going to, what students are going to need? And we're saying, these kids need certain kinds of learning experiences. And we need to, and those learning experiences are so unique and diverse, how do we provide a system of record to be able to demonstrate that to them and to their families? So the proficiency-based education was very good timing for us.
So I would describe our proficiency-based system as all of our core courses have graduation standards associated with it. Students here are required to demonstrate proficiency in each one of those graduation standards. And then there's this whole piece around, well, when you develop a competency-based model or proficiency-based model, that you have to throw out traditional letter grades, credit systems, and that's really the piece that we started to look at. And for us, we made, I think, some relatively controversial decisions around not transitioning to a 4-point grade scale.
Because we didn't change our grade scale, we kept the ABC and the, you know, 100-point scale, because we knew that that's what parents understood and we knew that that's what kids understood. So the transcript really did not change all that much, and I think that was a really smart thing on our part, because that would have been one of the things that parents probably would have gotten really, you know, cranked up about.
I think for families, having the grades associated with an A, a B, a C is very important for understanding how things are. If you shift and say it's proficiency-based and all standards-based diploma, most people in our community are not going to understand that language. But if we say you got an A, but if we break down the standards, see how your child has an A overall, but look, they have a B in how their listening and reading skills are in that standard, but they have an A plus in their conversational standard. So that's why it's bringing up your child's grade to that A.
So I like the standard aspect of it, because each class is broken into standards. We're able to work on different parts of the class. So instead of just saying, I'm doing well in English as a whole, we're able to focus what we're doing well on and focus what we may need work on. And that helps, I think, us when we're studying or wherever that may be. Because if you know that you need to focus on one aspect, it really does, you're able to focus on that a lot easier, whereas if it was just one simple grade, it would be harder to find what you need work on.
We firmly believe that in order for kids to be successful, that they must have the ability to revise or retake assessments and self-advocate for the extension of deadlines. I think I most value the fact that when kids don't get something, you know, it's not that that chapter is over and that, well, you know, we'll just keep going, that there's this really culture around the idea that we expect that you can do this, we believe that you can do this, and when you can't right away, it doesn't mean that you never will.
I think teachers struggle the most with the number of retakes that a student can have, because at some point, like, I really want to move on. I'm doing this work. I've got this held open for this student.
Teachers really were experiencing it for the first time then and were afraid that students wouldn't understand it, or they wouldn't know how to field these questions, or are we just going to be doing endless revisions? Like, kids are going to have so many attempts that they can just do it 1,000 times. And so I think part of it was coming to a conclusion that you can set, like, reasonable limits. So, like, in my class, students are able to revise, but I might give them a time limit.
So within our model, we disaggregate work habits. And what that means is that students are assessed on their ability to complete work on time. So whether it be practice work or assessment work, to be prepared for class, it's really those skills about being a student. The difference in this model is that all of that information isn't averaged in to their other grades. All of that information now is in a separate category. Where teachers can track those elements for students. And so students receive a work habits grade in every course in addition to a grade that indicates an average across the graduation standards.
And we made a really deliberate decision to post those work habits grades on the transcript. I know some schools who do standards-based opt to not do that, but we thought that was a really important thing to communicate to the world beyond Noble as well, because it talks about how a student approaches their work. And do they arrive on time? Do they do things on time? Do they have a strong work ethic?
The transition was confusing, honestly. It was weird to go from just getting whatever grade I got to all of a sudden there were these things called standards, and I had a work habits grade, and it was strange.
The one student that's impacted is the one who's really hardworking, but doesn't necessarily understand the content. So those are the kids who are used to coming in and doing extra credit if they didn't do well on the test or assessment or the project because they didn't really quite comprehend. And they suddenly didn't have that ability to come in and do the extra credit because they still needed to meet the standard. So those are the kids who struggle the most. They're really nice kids who work hard, and teachers want to give them a good grade because they're kind and they, you know, come to class every day and they're consistent, yet they're not quite getting it. The other kid who was impacted is the kid who is smart but doesn't do any of the homework and is just able to come in and do the assessment and do okay and, you know, get a good grade on the test or whatever it is that they're doing. So those kids loved this system.
We're the Noble Knights, so we have a thing called nighttime. And at nighttime, you can book with a teacher through the electronic systems we use to be able to say on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday this week, I really need time with that chemistry teacher, or I need more time with my Common Core math teacher.
Especially our students who have very full schedules and don't have tutorials or have jobs after school or play sports after school, sometimes they would really struggle to find a way to connect with teachers. So that, without a doubt, is something that all the kids benefit from. Some kids who don't need nighttime in the same way that other ones do, either that they just very easily meet graduation standards or are very efficient at their schoolwork, we often encourage them to participate in an honors option.
I feel like if I look at my numbers from way back when to now, there are fewer students who are failing. Yet I still have heterogeneously grouped students. So I have students who are struggling and students with, you know, 504s and IEPs and honor students and AP level students who are all in one class. And I do see that, I do see more being successful. And I think the revision piece is huge. And that nighttime piece is critical for that success.
I would definitely encourage schools to look at the opportunity of proficiency-based learning because it kind of forces students to get out of their comfort zone with being great at one thing and not so great at other things. And it really helps people become more well-rounded and things like that.
So we don't want to pretend that everything is perfect and that we're all done. We know we're still in development.